Penguin Random House Audio presents Scholars of Mayhem, My Father's Secret War in Nazi-Occupied France by Daniel C. Guiet and Timothy K. Smith. Read for you by Robert Fass. In memory of the members of Special Operations Executive Circuit Salesman 2, June 1944 to October 1944, Philippe Luer, Violette Sabo, Bob Maloubière, Jean-Claude Guiet, and the thousands of French civilians who gave their lives in the Limousin in the summer of 1944. Foreword. I stood with my father, Jean-Claude Guiet, by a corrugated metal hangar at the Lons-le-Saunier airport in eastern France, watching a blue-and-white Cessna 182 make its final approach. Jean-Claude did not allow the anticipation he felt to show in his expression. It was 9 a.m. on a sunny summer day that promised to build into a very hot Jura afternoon. A single tattered windsock fluttered in the light breeze. The Cessna was an old one, perfectly ordinary, except that someone had removed its transponder, the device that would have identified it to air traffic controllers. Its pilot was Bob Maloubière, a 77-year-old Frenchman wearing Ray-Bans and a handlebar mustache. In the co-pilot's seat rode his friend and former wife, Catherine, a beautiful and easygoing woman some 20 years his junior. 5 days before, on June 24, 2000, Bob and Jean-Claude had been reunited for the first time since the liberation of Paris in 1944. They had both attended the opening of a museum in Wormlo, England, devoted to the memory of Violette Sabo, an English secret agent who was a heroine of the French resistance. Bob, who stood 6'4", wore a chest full of medals and ribbons. Jean-Claude, who was 5'10", wore none of his. Their handshake turned into a long embrace. "My God, Jean, you've gotten very old," Bob said in French. Jean-Claude replied, "I'm still 6 months younger than you." The museum opening was a merry hubbub of war veterans, politicians, even a few movie stars, and the newspaper reporters and BBC film crew competing to interview them. It was no place for a real conversation. So Bob and Jean-Claude agreed to have a private reunion at the little chateau where my wife Carol and I spend summers in Neuvy-sur-Seye, a village of 250 souls in the Jura region. Bob would fly in from Paris, where he lived. They would have a chance to go over the extraordinary history they had shared with Violette, and also news about the 56 years since they had seen each other last. We watched the Cessna descend toward the grassy airstrip bordered by white-painted rocks. My father's face betrayed nothing. I was aflame with curiosity, especially as I knew that the wartime records of the unit both men had served with had finally been declassified. My father, a discreet, formal French-born American, a perfectionist in all he did, had never spoken of things that were officially secret. My thoughts drifted to the tin bread box that had traveled with our family everywhere the government-supplied moving vans took us during my peripatetic childhood. It was light gray, painted with pink hibiscus flowers. Wherever we lived, apartment, hotel, shanty, or house, the box would be tucked away in a hard-to-reach spot in my father's bedroom closet. There was never any food in it. It gave off no scent of crackers, bread, or nuts. Rather, it smelled faintly of rubberized plastic with undertones of old leather and canvas. We children didn't have to be told never to touch it. The box, it was understood, was strictly off limits. Opening it required considerable strength in the fingertips, I discovered at age 5. We were living in a Quonset hut on Saipan that year, 1956. My parents and my older sister were outside on the beach, taking in a picture-perfect Pacific sunset. The tin bread box had been placed within my reach for once, on the Quonset hut's floor among crates and suitcases as we were preparing to move yet again. I got my fingers under the narrow, rolled lip of the lid, popped it, and peered inside. I didn't understand most of the things I found. The 45 automatic was not a mystery, to be sure. I removed it carefully, along with 5 full clips. There were 3 slim knives, about 4 to 10 inches long, in leather sheaths with straps. There was also a length of wire with a wooden handle at each end. There were thin pieces of paper, 4 inches square, titled Field Station to Home Station and Home Station to Field Station, with tiny type printed on them in sequences of 5 random letters. There were black and white photos, with scalloped white borders, of men roasting monkeys in a jungle. I found passports and identification cards that bore my father's photograph, but names that were not his. There was a compass. A small green box, bound with a fat rubber band, contained narrow bits of metal with quarter-inch round wooden handles, a set of lock rakes, as I later learned. There were large silk squares imprinted with different countries' flags, bearing messages in unfamiliar alphabets. The messages, I discovered much later, were variations on a theme. I am an American. Take me to the nearest Allied military office. You will be paid. I put everything back into the box in the correct sequence and snapped the lid shut. The Cessna kissed the runway, its wheels sinking a little way into the grass, and taxied to the hangar. Bob and Catherine climbed out of the plane and into our car. It was a short ride to the chateau, along the bank of the Say River, through the village, through our gated wall, past our little vineyard and trout pond, and up to the 250-year-old house. We settled on the terrace with coffee. Bob began by asking Jean-Claude, "What did you do after being dragged off to the airport by the MPs?" He was alluding to their parting in Paris in September 1944. The 2 young men had survived their clandestine mission in occupied France, against long odds, and had made their way to the liberated capital. For 4 days they celebrated their good fortune, drinking, dancing, and dining in Paris's very expensive, very good black market restaurants. They had no desire to report to their commanding officers just yet, and that meant eluding the military policemen who patrolled the city rounding up reveling soldiers. Jean-Claude had 2 sets of papers, 1 French, 1 American, and he was perfectly bilingual. He was able to fool the French MPs by speaking only English when questioned, and the Americans by speaking French, but his luck ran out on day 4 when he was picked up by a joint French-American patrol. They took him in for questioning and ascertained his true identity. A few hours later, an older man in civilian clothing arrived hurriedly, and, escorted by 2 MPs, put Jean-Claude on the next flight to London. "I spent a few days at Baker Street," Jean-Claude replied. Number 64 Baker Street in London was, at that time, the headquarters of an organization called the Special Operations Executive, SOE. The few people who knew of its existence nicknamed it the Ministry of Ungentlemanly Warfare. Its operatives were sometimes called the Baker Street Irregulars. For any reader unfamiliar with the Sherlock Holmes canon, the original Baker Street Irregulars were London urchins who, in several stories, did intelligence work for the great detective. The men and women of SOE were certainly irregular in many senses of the word, but it wouldn't be quite right to think of them as spies. They were secret agents, to be sure, but they weren't trained just for espionage. Their job was mayhem, sabotage and subversion behind enemy lines. As one SOE officer told the historian M.R.D. Foote, "Our field operatives were, for the most part, temperamentally unable to regard intelligence as anything but the essential prelude to action. To whet their appetites for action by directing them to locate enemy activities or resources and at the same time to forbid action is akin to giving a lion a raw sirloin to play with but not to eat." The 2 old lions conversing at the chateau were the surviving members of a 4-person team that parachuted into Nazi-occupied France near Limoges on the day after D-Day. There they galvanized thousands of maquisards, rural bands of French guerrillas, to intercept German reinforcements and prevent them from reaching Normandy. Bob was a demolition specialist. Jean-Claude was the team's wireless operator, responsible for coded communications with Baker Street. They were not expected to survive. Before they got into the details of their wartime mission, though, Bob and Jean-Claude had some catching up to do. Jean-Claude told Bob that after his return to Baker Street, he had been shipped home to Northampton, Massachusetts, where both his parents were professors at Smith College. Then it was off to California for jungle training with the office.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.